Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Trivandrum editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our discussion. This news article is about the abolition of Legislative Council in Jammu and Kashmir. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. We know that in our country, we do not have a uniform organization structure at the level of state legislatures. This is because most of the states have only the state legislative assembly, whereas some states have both legislative assembly and also legislative council. In parliamentary parlance, the Legislative Council is also called as upper house in states, and it is also called as House of Elders and also as second chamber. And know that when we say state legislature, it includes the governor also along with the chamber or chambers as per Article 168 of Indian Constitution. If you see the next article, which is Article 169, it deals with abolition or creation of legislative councils in states. This article states that Parliament may by law provide for the abolition of the Legislative Council of a state which is having a Legislative Council, or for the creation of a Legislative Council in a state which does not have such council. But can Parliament do it unilaterally is the question. The answer is no. This is because before the Parliament enacts a law to create or abolish a Legislative Council, the Legislative Assembly of the concerned state has to pass a resolution for the abolition or creation of a Legislative Council. And this resolution shall be passed by a majority of the total membership of the Legislative Assembly and by a majority of not less than 2/3 of the members of the Assembly who are present and voting. So if this resolution is passed, yes, the Parliament may by law create or abolish Legislative Council in the concerned state. Now let us come to the news article. This news article is about the abolition of Legislative Council of Jammu and Kashmir. With respect to Jammu and Kashmir, we should note that the Legislative Council in Jammu and Kashmir was created on 26 January 1957 by the Article 46 of the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. This date, which is 26 January 1957, is the date in which the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir was made enforceable. But we know that at present, Indian Constitution applies to Jammu and Kashmir as per Article 370. This is because the temporary provisions with respect to Jammu and Kashmir was removed or abrogated in August 2019. Now know that way back in November 2018, the Legislative Assembly of the Jammu and Kashmir state was dissolved by the governor. And then in August 2019, the special status and the temporary provisions which were given to the state of Jammu and Kashmir have also been removed by declaration of the president. So during August and even now, there is no Legislative Assembly in Jammu and Kashmir. But then the news is the Legislative Council has been abolished. But we saw that to create or abolish a Legislative Council, the consent of the respective state legislative assembly is required. So how did this happen? This is because this abolition is based on the Act of Parliament that bifurcated the state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. One, the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir with legislative assembly, and next the union territory of Ladakh without a legislative assembly. And this act is called as the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act of 2019. Now, Section 57 of this Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act has the provisions to abolish the Legislative Council of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Also, as a result, based on this section, all the bills that are pending in the Legislative Council shall lapse. That is, they expire on the abolition of the council. If you see, in true spirit of Article 169 of Indian Constitution, this abolition is questionable in the court of law because there is no resolution passed by the State Legislative Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir. So this is the first part which has been discussed in the news article, which is related to the abolition of State Legislative Council. Now this news article also talks about the Delhi Agreement of 1952. If you see, this agreement was between the state government of Jammu and Kashmir and the central government. And this agreement dealt with the citizenship matters, then matters to legislate between the center and state, then about emergency, then also about various other issues with respect to the ways and manner in which Jammu and Kashmir was accession to Indian Union. And this agreement also contains some special features. Next, this news article also talks about the Delhi-Srinagar Accord of 1975. This accord is also called as Indira Gandhi-Sheikh Abdullah Accord, since it was signed between Indira Gandhi and Sheikh Abdullah. This accord is also called as Kashmir Accord. Now let us see two important provisions of this accord. The first important provision is that the state of Jammu and Kashmir is a constituent of the Union of India, and the relations of Jammu and Kashmir with the Union of India shall be governed by Article 370 of the Constitution of India. The second important provision is that the Indian Parliament will have the power to make laws to prevent any questioning, disclaiming or disrupting the sovereignty and territorial integrity of India, or the Indian Parliament will have the power to make laws to prevent secession of any part of the Indian territory from the Union. So these are the two important provisions of this Indira Gandhi Sheikh Abdullah Accord or the Delhi-Srinagar Accord. So in this news article, we have discussed about the abolition of Legislative Council in Jammu and Kashmir, then briefly about the Delhi Agreement of 1952, and finally also about the Kashmir Accord of 1975. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article speaks about India Innovation Index. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Know that India Innovation Index is released by Niti Aayog along with Institute for Competitiveness. Here, know that Institute for Competitiveness is the knowledge partner. This Institute for Competitiveness India is the Indian branch of the global network of the Institute for Strategy and Competitiveness at Harvard Business School. So it is an international initiative which is centered in India. Now, one of the functions of this Institute for Competitiveness is to provide advisory services to the governments. Hence, Niti Aayog has partnered with Institute for Competitiveness to release this index. Now, let us see the index. This index is based on the study of the innovation ecosystem of the states of India and also the union territories of India. So, in this particular study, the capabilities and the performance of the Indian states and union territories have been studied. This study is an outcome of extensive research and analysis. So, Niti Aayog along with Institute for Competitiveness has done extensive research and analysis over the innovation landscape of India. They have examined the innovation capabilities and the performance of the Indian states and union territories. So, the aim of this index is to create a holistic tool which can be used by the policy makers across the country. So, the policy makers will identify the challenges that needs to be addressed and the strengths which they must build on when designing their economic growth policies for their regions. So, this is the aim of this India Innovation Index. And know that India Innovation Index 2019 has been calculated as the average of the scores based on two dimensions. One dimension is enablers and the second dimension is performance. Enablers are nothing but the capabilities that a particular state or a union territory has. So, they have been grouped in five pillars. Here, the first pillar is the human capital, that is the human resource. The second pillar is the investment, that is the money. The third pillar is the knowledge workers. Then the fourth pillar, business environment. And the fifth pillar, safety and legal environment. And if you see the performance dimension, there are two pillars. One pillar is the knowledge output. And the second pillar is the knowledge diffusion. That is how much of knowledge has been transferred, or we can say disseminated. This index also includes a section on the state profiles, which covers around 33 indicators. And these 33 indicators are based on the different facets of innovation in India. So just know that there are 33 indicators as a part of this index. Now let us see the key outcomes of this index. This index shows that the innovation ecosystem of the country is strong in south and western parts of India. In fact, if you see, three of the top five major states are from south part of India. The only exceptions are the states of Delhi and Haryana. So we can see that there is a west, south and a northeast divide across the country, especially for this index. Now the states and the union territories have been categorized into three categories. One category is the major states. The second category is the northeastern and the hill states. And the third category is the union territories, city states, and the small states. So this is for the purpose of ranking. Under the major state category, Karnataka has got the number one position in the overall ranking. This is followed by the states of Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra. And under the category of northeastern and hill states, Sikkim is the number one state, followed by the states of Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. And under the category of union territories, city states, and small states, Delhi is in the number one position in this particular category. This is followed by Chandigarh and the state of Goa. So, as a part of this study, the states have been ranked based on different categories, and this study has also given some suggestions that needs to be carried forward at the national level and the state level. Now let us see some of the key suggestions given by this index at the national level. One suggestion is that the spending on the research and development needs to be increased. And the second suggestion is that the capabilities of the top educational institutions in the country has to be improved in such a way that they produce greater innovation outputs. And one more suggestion has been given, which is the need for coordination and collaboration between the industry and the educational institutions for enhancing the innovation capabilities. So it suggests for a collaborative platform. This collaborative platform shall consist of all the stakeholders of the innovation. That is, those who are taking part in this process. It involves the innovators, it involves the researchers, then it also involves the investors who provide the investment. Mainly the investors are from the industry. So a collaborative platform consisting of all these stakeholders shall be developed. So this will help in strengthening the industry-academia linkages, and it will also ease the process of technology transfer by providing a platform for the innovators to showcase their inventions. Now let us see some of the suggestions given for the states. One is forming policies at the state level in order to improve the innovation and entrepreneurial ecosystem. And the second area of focus which has been suggested by this index is the cluster development programs. So more coordination can be done on these cluster development programs. The next suggestion given in this index is that the industrial policies which are being framed by the different states should also focus more on innovation. At present, if we see, only few policies exist for the innovation, even in the most innovative states and union territories as per this index study. So this is all about this index. From prelims point of view, know who has released this index and the aim of this index, and some of the top ranking states of this index, and also the dimensions of the index. Now you can make use of the outcomes of this index and also the key takeaways, that is the suggestions that have been given in this index, in your mains answers, especially for those questions that deal with the economy, that deal with policy making, etc. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the recently released Global Tuberculosis Report of 2019. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. In the context of this news article, first let us discuss in brief about tuberculosis. Tuberculosis, or TB, is caused by a bacterium which is called as Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It is most often, if you see, the tuberculosis affects the lungs. And know that tuberculosis is curable and preventable. And the transmission of this particular infection happens from person to person through air. Though medicines are available, inappropriate use of the drug has resulted in development of drug resistance. Here you should know that isoniazid and rifampicin are the two most powerful first-line anti-tuberculosis drugs. When an individual does not respond to these two medicines, then they suffer from multi-drug resistance tuberculosis. In order to overcome this, second-line drugs can be used. But certain individuals who are affected with tuberculosis do not respond to the most effective second-line anti-tuberculosis drugs. This case is called as extensively drug-resistant tuberculosis, or XDR-TB. We have discussed about tuberculosis in detail during our 16th August 2019 analysis. Just have a look at it for further subject clarity. Now let us see the Global Tuberculosis Report. This report is released by the World Health Organization. So the World Health Organization has published a global tuberculosis report every year since 1997. The purpose of this report is to provide a comprehensive and up-to-date assessment of the tuberculosis epidemic and it will also provide the progress in response to the epidemic at global level, regional level and country level. In the year 2019, data on tuberculosis were reported by 202 countries and territories. If you see, these 202 countries and territories account for more than 99% of the world's population and estimated number of tuberculosis cases. So this data includes trends in tuberculosis incidence, then trends on tuberculosis mortality, then data on case detection, then about the treatment results of tuberculosis, then about multidrug resistant tuberculosis, HIV associated tuberculosis, then it also discusses about tuberculosis prevention, universal health coverage, etc. This tuberculosis report reveals that countries are making progress in terms of providing quality tuberculosis care and also reduction in tuberculosis related deaths, etc. But still, tuberculosis remains the top infectious killer worldwide because about 10 million people have fallen ill because of tuberculosis in the year 2018. In this context, it is to be noted that in the year 2018, United Nations General Assembly had held the first ever high-level meeting on tuberculosis. The objective of this particular meeting was to accelerate the efforts in ending tuberculosis and reach all the affected people with prevention and care. And also, if you see, the improvements that are made in combating this tuberculosis are in line with the Sustainable Development Goal and also in line with End Tuberculosis Program of the World Health Organization. Now, if you see the Sustainable Development Goal, it speaks about the Sustainable Development Goal 3, which is good health and well-being. And there is a target 3.3. As per this Sustainable Development Goal target number 3.3, by 2030, tuberculosis has to be eliminated. And now let us see the End Tuberculosis Program or the End Tuberculosis Strategy of the World Health Organization. This End Tuberculosis Strategy aims to end the global tuberculosis epidemic. There are some targets. One target is to reduce tuberculosis deaths by 95% and to cut new cases by 90% between the year 2015 and 2035, and also to ensure that no family is burdened with huge expenses due to tuberculosis. Now let us come back to the news article. Here the news article compares the tuberculosis data for the years 2017 and 2018. It says that tuberculosis incidence rate in India has decreased by almost 50,000 patients over the past 1 year. According to the news article, in the year 2017, India had 27.4 lakh tuberculosis patients. But in the year 2018, this came down to 26.9 lakh. But the report tells that out of this 26.9 lakh, only about 21.5 lakh cases were reported. So we can see that there is a huge gap between the actual number of cases and the reported cases. Here it is almost more than 5 lakh. Next, this news article compares the tuberculosis incidence rate. Here the tuberculosis incidence rate means the number of tuberculosis incidence cases per 1 lakh population. This rate was 204 in the year 2017. It came down to 199 in the year 2018. So this shows that the overall number of tuberculosis patients and the incidence rates have decreased over the years. Next, the news article talks about tuberculosis patients who were tested for rifampicin resistance. As we know, rifampicin is one of the frontline drug for tuberculosis. So it is a case of drug resistant tuberculosis. The number of patients being diagnosed for resistance to rifampicin has increased from 32% in the year 2017 to 46% in the year 2018. Next, let us compare the treatment success rate over the years for tuberculosis. According to the Global Tuberculosis Report 2018, the treatment success rate was 69% for the year 2016. And as per the 2019 report, this treatment success rate has increased to 81% in the year 2017. This means that over the years, our success in fighting tuberculosis is increasing. And in the final part of this news article, you can see the mention about India Tuberculosis Report 2019. Know that India Tuberculosis Report 2019 was released by the Central Tuberculosis Division. This division comes under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Earlier, we also saw that there is a gap between the actual number of tuberculosis cases and the reported cases. Now, in order to address this, the India TB report says that Nikshay has been launched by India. So this Nikshay is taking India closest ever in covering all the tuberculosis cases. So what is this Nikshay? Nikshay is actually an online case-based real-time patient management system. So this program offers the program managers the ability to monitor their patients in real time. It captures data like the details of the patients, then the treatment initiation status, then the laboratory tests that have been done for the patients, then the compliance of the patients to the treatment, and also the treatment outcomes and many such parameters. So we can see that this Niksha is a real-time patient management system. So in this news article, we have seen in brief about tuberculosis, then about global tuberculosis report, then in brief about India tuberculosis report 2019, and about Niksha portal. Let us move on to the next news article. This editorial is mainly on urbanization, how urbanization will remain a strong trend in this century. But if you see, the countries and the major cities of the world are failing to have a climate-centric approach towards building the necessary infrastructure in the cities. So as a part of this, some suggestions have been given by the author towards building a climate-centric infrastructure in the cities, especially in the Indian context. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. This editorial discusses in detail about the suggestions put forward by the recently held C40 World Mayor Summit in 2019. The summit was held at Copenhagen in Denmark. So in this context, let us discuss about C40 group and the suggestions that have been put forward by the recent summit and some of the key takeaways for India which the author has discussed. First, let us discuss C40. C40 is a network of the world's mega cities which are committed to address climate change. It was founded in 2005 in London, the capital of United Kingdom. This C40 network supports the cities to collaborate effectively to share the knowledge and to drive meaningful, measurable, and sustainable action on climate change. Around the world, if you see, the C40 cities connect 94 of the world's greatest cities to take bold climate actions. And those cities that are from India, which form a part of the C40, are the cities of Delhi, National Capital Territory, then the city of Bengaluru, then Chennai and Kolkata. And also know that Jaipur city in Rajasthan is mentioned as a temporarily inactive member. This group represents 700 plus million citizens, and it also represents 1/4 of the global economy. And the mayors of the C40 cities are committed to deliver the most ambitious goals of the Paris Climate Agreement at local level. So what is this Paris Climate Agreement? Let us see in brief, which is required for this editorial discussion. Know that the Paris Climate Agreement was framed at the 21st session of the Conference of Parties of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which happened in Paris in the year 2015. One of the important aim of this agreement is to keep the rise in global temperature well below 2 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial levels, and the countries should continue their efforts to limit the global temperature to 1.5 degrees Celsius. So many countries are taking action to meet the agreed goals in this Paris Climate Agreement. In line with this, recently, the C40 World Mayor Summit 2019 was held at Copenhagen in Denmark. The discussions and the suggestions that came up during the summit is important for India. As we all know that the urbanization or the shift of the population from the rural to urban areas is a strong trend which is happening in the present 21st century. And here, the author of this editorial has mentioned about the special report on global warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius, which was issued by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in the year 2018. As per this report, every year about 70 million people will be drawn towards cities and towns for the next 3 decades. Now, just let us see a small statistics for India with regards to the urban population. In 2011 census, India has around 37.7 crores of urban population. So the level of urbanization has increased from 27.81, which was as per the 2001 census, to 31.16% as per the 2011 census. And this trend is likely to continue in the coming years as well. So we can see that urbanization is the trend of the present century. So the author of this editorial is telling that the mayors of the cities worldwide and also the state governments in India must prepare for difficult times, and they should come up with action plans for urban centers. Now, why the C40 cities are so concerned about climate change? The author tells that these cities represent an estimated 70% of global carbon dioxide emissions. And also, nearly 90% of the urban areas are at high risk from extreme climate events such as storms because they are situated along coastlines. And another worrying fact is that these cities are home to millions of population, but many of them are poor and ill-equipped to handle floods. And the cities also endure cycles of drought and heat waves apart from the floods. So we can see that there are challenges to the cities, not only from the floods, but also from droughts and heat waves. And according to the author, the cities over the world generate over 80% of the world's GDP. So they're called as the powerhouses. And the author feels that these powerhouses should be the driving force for the mitigation of climate change. So this is the meaning of greening the powerhouses, which is the title of this editorial. Now let us discuss the key takeaways for India. As we have seen, India still has only 31.16% of its population in the urban areas. This means that much of the urban infrastructure in India remains to be built. When we compare with the cities of the developed world where there is already a well-built infrastructure. So this is an opportunity for the Indian policymakers who have to ensure that the future planning must be climate-centric. Now in the summit, the mayors from the major cities have spoken about the expensive plan to retrofit or modify their urban infrastructure so that there is an improvement in the energy efficiency. But India need not repeat this cycle of building or retrofitting if it builds the climate-centric infrastructure right from the start. So the author is telling that right from the planning stage, India must focus on green infrastructure so that it will leapfrog the era of dirty fuel. That is, it will quickly jump over few stages when there is already a climate-centric infrastructure right from the start. Next, the author tells that India's fast expanding cities and towns need some far-sighted measures. That is, whatever measures they take now must be futuristic. For this, the author has mentioned some of the measures that have already been adopted or those that have been planned by certain cities across the world. And these measures have been discussed in this summit. One is that the suggestion which has been given by the mayor of Rome to ban the diesel emissions and to encourage the sustainable shared mobility, including biking and walking. Next, one good practice from the city of Hangzhou in China has been mentioned. This city has the largest public bicycle sharing system and it is also moving to a smart bus service. Now, a smart bus service system has features such as faster buses, integration with subway lines, then bike sharing system, then pre-ticketing smart card, etc. Then one more best practice from the city of Hong Kong has been mentioned. The city of Hong Kong has constructed new drainage tunnels which will harvest the rains that occur because of typhoons so that it will be able to reuse rainwater and grow biodiversity. Also, a plan of Singapore has been mentioned where Singapore is planning to price the carbon so that it can reduce the emissions. So these are some of the best practices and measures mentioned by the author. But the current trend is that climate change is not integral to the city planning, despite the risk it poses to the residents and the economic assets of the cities. So the author tells that innovation, technology and financing, that is investment, is required to adapt to adverse impacts of climate change like droughts, floods and heat islands. Here, know that an urban heat island occurs when a city experiences much warmer temperatures when compared to the nearby rural areas. And in this summit, Kolkata has also bagged an award for green mobility. And the Delhi chief minister had participated in the summit through video conferencing. Here, he has informed the delegates that Delhi was cutting its emissions by inducting 1,000 electric buses, then by planting trees on a massive scale, and also by eliminating the use of dangerous industrial chemicals. And this editorial also tells that the Delhi chief minister stressed on the need for determined policies to ensure inclusive and green urban spaces, then to ensure sustainable mobility, then to ensure protected water sources, and also to ensure reduction of waste. So all this will reduce the carbon emissions and it will empower the common citizens to live a better life. Now, moving on to the last key takeaway which the author has suggested is that the Union Environment Ministry, that is the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change, must help the states to come up with city level action plans which should be in the true spirit of the Paris Agreement, nothing but to address climate change. So overall, the author of this editorial is telling that India's urban governance should move to a better trajectory and the focus must be on lowering the emissions and introducing measures such as incentivizing eco-friendly designs. Basically, to build a climate-centric infrastructure. So all these city-level measures will enable India to tackle the impacts of climate change and it will also show that India is a true international leader in mitigating global threats such as climate change. So this is all about this editorial. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is titled as Brimming SRSP Raises Hope in ICAT Farmers. Here the word brimming means nearing to full storage capacity. Here it refers to the full storage capacity of Shriram Sagar project. And the word ICAT means the command area, that is the irrigated land of the dam. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your better understanding. This news article mentions that the water level has been gradually rising in Shriram Sagar project, which is located in Nizamabad district of Telangana. It tells that the water level is close to reach the full reservoir level of the dam. In this context, we'll be seeing about the details of the dam and on which river it is located. Know that this project is located on the Godavari River. So, we shall also be seeing in detail about Godavari River, its major tributaries and some other important dams that are located on River Godavari. Know that Godavari River originates from Trayambakeshwar. Trayambakeshwar is located in Nashik district in the state of Maharashtra. And Godavari River empties in Bay of Bengal. And note that Godavari River is the second longest river after Ganga. The length of Ganga is 2525 kilometers and the length of Godavari is 1465 kilometers. So, Godavari River is the second longest river in India after Ganga. River Godavari drains the states of Maharashtra, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Odisha and Karnataka, and finally it empties into the Bay of Bengal through its extensive network of tributaries. So, there are a lot of tributaries for this Godavari River. Now we shall see the tributaries based on its bank, that is the right bank and the left bank. The important right bank tributaries of Godavari River are Pravara, Manjira, Manayar, Kinnarsani, etc. as you can see in this picture. And the important left bank tributaries are Purna, Pranahita, Indravati, Sabari, etc. Next, let us see the important dams that are located on this Godavari River. One is the Babli Dam, which is located in the state of Maharashtra. Next is the Shriram Sagar project, which is our news article. It is also called as Pochambadu Dam. It is located in the Nizamabad district of Telangana. Next, the Nizam Sagar Reservoir, which is located on Manjira River, which is a tributary of Godavari River. This Nizam Sagar is located in Telangana. Then we have the Kaleshwaram Dam, which is located on Godavari at the confluence of Pranahita and Godavari River. This is also located in the state of Telangana. Next, we have Ichampalli Dam. It is located at the confluence of Indravati River and Godavari. It is also located in Telangana. And we also have Polavaram River project on Godavari, which is located in Andhra Pradesh. So, it is a river linking project of Godavari River with Krishna River. So, these are some of the important dams and projects that are located on River Godavari. And as we saw, Shriram Sagar project is located near Pochambadu village in the Nizamabad district of Telangana. And it is a multi-purpose irrigation project. So, from prelims point of view, know some details like where the river is originating, then the tributaries of Godavari River, then about the important dams that are located on the Godavari River. So, all these are important from prelims point of view. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now, see the first question. The questioners consider the following statements with reference to state legislative councils. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. Here, the first statement is correct. It is Article 169 of Indian Constitution. Now, see the second statement. It tells that such law as aforesaid shall be deemed to be an amendment of this constitution for the purposes of Article 368. Now, know that Article 368 speaks about constitutional amendment acts. This statement is wrong. So, whatever law that is made by the parliament does not amount to constitutional amendment act under Article 368. This question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 11B. Now see the next question. The questioners consider the following statements with reference to India Innovation Index 2019. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement is correct. It is the aim of the index. And the second statement, it is also correct. It is released by Niti Aayog with Institute for Competitiveness as the knowledge partner. So, the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Now, see the next question. The question is, consider the following statements regarding Nikshay portal. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. Here, the first statement, it tells that it is an online portal which captures the data of malnourishment among the children in India. This statement is wrong. During our discussion, we saw that it is a case-based real-time patient management system for those patients suffering from tuberculosis. So the first statement is wrong. See the second statement. It tells that it was developed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This statement is correct. Know that the system has been developed jointly by the Central Tuberculosis Division of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare along with National Informatics Center. Now, if they have given the statement as it was developed by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare only, then the statement is wrong. But this is a general statement, so this statement is correct. This question has asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now see the next question. The question is, consider the following statements regarding C40. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements again. The first statement is correct. The second statement, it tells that no Indian cities are a part of C40. This statement is wrong because during our discussion we saw that cities of Delhi, Bengaluru, Chennai and Kolkata are part of this C40 network, and Jaipur is mentioned as a temporarily inactive member. This question is asked for the correct statements. The correct answer is option A, 1 only. Now see the next question. The question is, consider the following statements with reference to Godavari River. They have given four statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. The first statement, it tells that it originates in the Western Ghats near Mahabaleshwar and empties in the Bay of Bengal. This statement is wrong. It originates from Trimbakeshwar. See the next statement. It tells that the river drains five states only. This statement is also wrong. Now the next statement, it tells Manjira is the right bank tributary of river Godavari. This one is correct. Now see the next statement. It tells that Sriram Sagar project is at the confluence of Pranhita with Godavari. This statement is wrong. It is the Kaleshwaram dam which is located at the confluence of Pranhita with Godavari river, not Sriram Sagar project. So only the third statement is correct here. The correct answer is option B. All statements are incorrect but three. With this we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. Thank you.